The Assembly will now hear an address by His Excellency David Arthur Granger, President of the Republic of Guyana, and I request protocol to escort His Excellency. And while that escorting is taking place, I remind the membership again for the need for silence, particularly at the edge of the hall. And no conversation knots, please, by diplomats and members of the Secretariat in the aisles. Thank you. People on mobile phones standing in the aisle. Yes, sir. I'm looking at you. Please, can we exit if we're not seated, listening to the general debate, showing respect to members of state? Thank you. Be seated, or please exit the hall. So on behalf of the General Assembly, I now have the honor to welcome to the United Nations His Excellency David Arthur Granger, President of the Republic of Guyana, to invite him to address the Assembly.
Thank you, Mr. President. Heads of state and government, Secretary General of the United Nations, delegates, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the Cooperative Republic of Guyana congratulates you, Mr. Peter Thompson, on your election as President of the 71st session of the United Nations General Assembly. The election of a representative of Fiji, a small island developing state, to preside over the General Assembly at this session is especially gratifying. The choice of the theme for our general debate, the Sustainable Development Goals, a universal push to transform our world, is most appropriate. We thank His Excellency Mr. Mogens Litikoff, the outgoing president of the historic 70th session, for his guidance of the Assembly over the past year. Guyana commends Secretary General Ban Ki-moon for his stellar stewardship of the United Nations during his decennium. The international community owes him an enormous debt of gratitude for his earnest efforts and indefatigable exertions to alleviate human distress, to promote peace, and to sustain development around the world. Excellencies, the Secretary General's courageous campaign to combat the adverse effects of climate change and his commitment to sustainable development have been transformative. His labors bore fruit in the adoption of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development in September 2015 and the signing of the Paris Agreement on Climate Change in April 2016. The agenda and the agreement, most memorably, made a massive impact on the manner in which the world manages the environment. The agenda and the agreement are evidence of the environmental common sense. They are the most excellent examples of the sort of collective action most likely to ensure a sustainable future and a safe planet. They are harbingers of hope for everyone, everywhere, forever. The Secretary General's leadership has led the United Nations irreversibly further along a green path. We thank him heartily. Mr. President, Guyana is part of this global green movement. Our natural assets, our commitment to sustainable development, our contribution to countering the adverse effects of climate change, and our collaboration with the international community in seeking solutions to global threats have distinguished us as an emergent green state. We are a state that will ensure a secure future for our people in the pursuit of a green economy. We are a state that is proud of its place as a reliable and cooperative partner in the international efforts to protect the Earth's environment. Guyana recognizes the interlocking objectives of the agenda and the agreement. It realizes that the establishment of a green state is consistent with building climate resilience while mitigating the effects of climate change. Guyana promises to continue to work towards the agenda's goals, particularly by contributing to limiting increases in global temperatures, and to work towards a green path of development that is in accord with the agreement's nationally determined commitments. Guyana serendipitously stands at the center of the Guyana Shield, one of the world's last remaining spheres of virgin tropical rainforest. The Guyana Shield spans an area of 2.7 million square kilometers, an area larger than Greenland, an area that is shared by six South American countries, parts of Brazil and Colombia, all of Guyana, all of La Guyane, all of Suriname, and part of Venezuela. Guyana is part of that shield, and Guyana is a net carbon sink. A green canopy of rainforest envelops more than 85% of our land mass, the second highest percentage forest cover on Earth. Guyana is pursuing a green path so as to understand better how to protect our precious biodiversity and manage our complex ecosystems sustainably. Mr. President, Guyana made a covenant with the world to be an exemplar of green growth in 1989, 3 years before the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development in Rio de Janeiro in 1992. We made a gift with the prospect of sustainable development and to a project to protect our environment through our generous grant of 371,000 hectares of our pristine rainforest to be used as an international model for research, training, and the development of technologies which will promote the conservation and the sustainable and equitable use of tropical rainforest in a manner that will lead to lasting ecological, economic, and social benefits to the people of Guyana and the world in general. The Iwukrama International Center for Rainforest Conservation and Development, located in the center of our country and at the heart of the Guyana Shield, survives and thrives as a testament of Guyana's commitment to sustainable development and environmental conservation. Guyana is an important partner in the global environmental movement. It entered into an agreement with the Kingdom of Norway to provide the world with a relevant, replicable model of how RED plus the mechanism for reducing emissions from deforestation and forest degradation can align the development objectives of forest countries and the need to combat climate change. Guyana entered agreements also with the Kingdom of the Netherlands, the Federal Republic of Germany, the State of Japan, and other states and international organizations. Guyana reaffirms its commitment to goal number 15 of the agenda, under which United Nations member states pledged to protect, restore, and promote sustainable use of terrestrial ecosystems, sustainably manage forests, combat desertification, and halt and reverse land degradation and halt biodiversity loss. Guyana is improving the management of its ecosystems and natural resources in order to conserve its forests and their rich biodiversity. We will fulfill our obligation contained in the intended nationally determined commitments under the Paris Agreement. Guyana will deepen its research by establishing an international institute for biodiversity at the Iwukrama International Center for Rainforest Conservation and Development. That institute will allow scientists and students from the Caribbean and all around the world to come to our country to increase their knowledge of vital ecosystems and to share in the study of Guyana's shield and its amazing biodiversity. Mr. President, the agenda's goal number 15 urges us to take urgent action to combat climate change and its impact. This goal envisages and encourages international cooperation to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and to abate the adverse impacts of climate change. The agreement obligates member states to take action to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius and above pre-industrial levels, and to foster climate resilience and low greenhouse gas emissions development in a manner that does not threaten food production. Guyana is developing a comprehensive emissions reductions program as part of its responsibility to contribute to global solutions to the threat of climate change. We will set aside an additional 2 million hectares of our territory for conservation purposes. Guyana is pursuing a low-carbon growth trajectory to enhance our contribution to the campaign against climate change through the preservation of our forests within the ambit of REDD+ mechanism. We will contribute up to 48.7 million metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent to the global mitigation effort through a program of avoided emissions. Mr. President, the agreement on climate change and the agenda both emphasize the importance of financial flows towards supporting the efforts of states pursuing a green path to development in meeting its adaptation and mitigation obligations and in implementing intended nationally determined commitments. I am constrained to state, however, that all of our efforts nationally, regionally, and globally for the advancement of development in an environment of peace and stability are being challenged by the territorial ambitions of our neighbor, the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. Mr. President, Guyana celebrated the 50th anniversary of independence this year. Venezuela regrettably acknowledged this anniversary by reasserting on the 26th of May, our Independence Day, its repudiation of a border treaty it had solemnly signed 117 years ago and ratified and respected for over 60 of those years. Mr. President, I addressed this assembly last year and warned of the danger that Venezuela posed to the peace and security of our region, not by its internal instability, but by its external assault on Guyana's sovereignty and territorial integrity. I placed hope in the fact that the process for the final resolution of Venezuela's unworthy territorial claims rested now in the hands of the Secretary General of the United Nations. Venezuela, for a full year since I spoke, has stalled every means as it intensified its aggression against Guyana and thwarted all of the Secretary General's efforts to pursue a way forward, at least in terms of a process that promises final resolution to this controversy. Mr. President, Guyana stands ready to have the International Court of Justice determine the matter with finality. Guyana will work resolutely with the Secretary General in his final month of office to free our country and his successor from this surreal burden. Venezuela agreed in the Geneva Agreement of 1966 that the United Nations Secretary General shall determine the means of settlement of this controversy, including by judicial settlement. Yet, Venezuela defies his every effort to fulfill that commitment. The United Nations cannot be dispassionate party to a threat to peace anywhere and to a challenge to the law of nations. Venezuela's territorial claim is such a challenge. It strikes at the heart of the United Nations. It strikes at the heart of its trusteeship of the law of nations. It strikes at the heart of the charter which the Secretary General upholds. Guyana, a small state, must look to the United Nations for protection against threats to its security, for intervention for peace, and for respect for international law. Mr. President, my plea for international understanding of our plight has nothing to do with Venezuela's internal situation, The ordinary people of Venezuela are our sisters and brothers. Their pain touches our hearts, and we wish them early relief from their agony. Venezuela's claims, however, are a threat to Guyana's existence as an independent nation. They are a scandalous revival of the conquistadorial disease that once plagued Venezuela's own history. They are a crime against our humanity, clothed in the verbiage of national honor. Mr. President, I wish also to iterate Guyana's continued support within the context of the preservation of sovereignty and its link with sustainable development for the complete removal of the commercial, economic, and financial blockade imposed by the United States of America against another Caribbean country, the Republic of Cuba. We cannot commit to policies to transform our economies, to provide development for our peoples, and do not demonstrate the political will to change systems that are in direct contradiction to those policies. Mr. President, Guyana is on a path to becoming a green state. Its efforts and those of other small states, however, can be derailed unless there is collective commitment by the greater part of the international community to collaborate with those states which are determined to pursue a low-carbon, low-emission path to sustainable development and to constraining the rise of global temperatures. The road from Stockholm in 1972 to Paris in 2015 has been long and difficult. The words of the Declaration of the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment, however, remain as relevant in 2016 as they were 44 years ago in 1972. And I quote, Mr. President, "A point has been reached in history when we must shape our actions throughout the world with a more prudent care for their environmental consequences. Through ignorance or indifference, we can do massive and irreversible harm to the earthly environment on which our life and well-being depend. Conversely, through fuller knowledge and wiser action, we can achieve for ourselves and our posterity a better life in an environment more in keeping with human needs and hopes. To defend and impose and improve the human environment for present and future generations has become an imperative goal for mankind." Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, the General Assembly of this 71st session now has the opportunity and the obligation to commit to measures to defend and improve the human environment for present and future generations, thereby making the road forward into the future an easier one for posterity. Venezuela's aggression against Guyana should not be allowed to threaten our children's future. Mr. President, I thank you.
On behalf of the General Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Guyana for the statement just made. May I request representatives to remain seated while we greet the President.